Hi guys, it's Jonathan Graham here for Guitar Interactive, and we are here with Jerry Horton from the incredible Papa Roach. How are you doing today, buddy?
Great, man. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good, man. Now, I hear last night's show was pretty killer. Let's hear it from your perspective. How was it?
Yeah, the crowd was amazing. I mean, it's a typical UK London crowd. It was... I actually heard it from a lot of people last night that it was really like... Yes, it was sold out, but it seemed like it was really sold out. And so it was really hot and sweaty and the air was thick, and it just, you know, some people were a little uncomfortable, but sometimes that makes for a great show. So.
Well, that's it. It's not a proper, you know, metal show unless you're a little bit uncomfortable,
yeah,
is it? You know,
totally.
What I mean? So just before we started rolling there, you happened to mention there's a few places on this date, on these dates that are coming up, the tour dates in the UK, that you haven't actually played before.
Yeah.
You want to tell us a little bit about those?
Yeah, we're doing Edinburgh, Aberdeen, Norwich, and a couple other ones that are escaping me right now. But yeah, just we wanted to kind of spread out, and you know, we do the normal 6 gigs or whatever, but not everybody can make it.
Yeah.
You know, so we wanted to kind of spread it out, take it to the people, if you will. And we've gotten loads of comments, you know, on social media saying thank you for coming out and doing that, and making it a lot easier on the people to make it out.
It's kind of interesting because, you know, a lot of you guys, your big American bands, will come over and then you'll hear us sort of complaining, oh man, I got to travel 50 miles.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm sure when you're doing your US dates, sometimes people will maybe have to go hundreds of miles,
yep,
to get to you. So it's understandable, I suppose, that you'll just keep playing the same sort of 6 places. But was it just sort of fan generated then that just made you guys think, oh, let's play these places because people want to see us there?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, we're not ones to, you know, come down on anybody for anything. It's like, you know, if you can't make it out, all right, well then let's try something different, you know? And it's just, I feel like it's sort of reconnecting us with a lot of people who maybe haven't been able to come out for a long time.
And new record out, who do you trust is out finally, you know, been waiting up? Well, actually not too bad, because there was a little bit of a gap there where you guys weren't doing anything new, but now a couple of years in a row really we've seen some new records. How do you feel now that this new record's out and you're getting a great response from the fans?
We're getting amazing response. You know, we always going in, we think, you know, is everybody gonna like it, you know, and all that. But we've gotten with some producers that are, you know, super energetic and amazing guys, and grew up listening to us, you know, and helping us bring back that energy that we had, and kind of the experimentation and all that we had when we were writing, you know, Infest or whatever. And that has really re-energized us musically, creatively, and then obviously transitioning that to the stage. Mm. And you know, we're seeing a lot of younger people coming out to the shows, especially here, which is great. You know, it's like for us, obviously we're older, so our fans are older, so you know, those kinds of people really just want to be back by the bar having a pint or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
But the kids in the front, they're the ones that want to go off and get in the pit and do that.
How did this album come about? Was it quite quick, the writing process?
This one, we went in a couple of times. So it was quick in the main body of the whole thing. But on the last album cycle, we had finished the album and we were slated to go on tour with Of Mice and Men, and Austin got sick and had to cancel. So we had to cancel the tour. And instead of just sitting at home doing nothing, we decided to go back in the studio. So it was right after we put out Crooked Teeth, we went back in the studio, and we started writing then. And we got a couple of songs that weren't totally finished, but became the basis for Who Do You Trust and Maniac. And so, you know, normally we would go in, you know, historically we would get in the rehearsal space and jam out and play and, you know, write songs for about a month and then go into the studio. Last couple of records, it's been get in there and get to it, you know, and it's a little bit nerve-wracking, but we finally learned that, you know, if you can sit down and talk about the intention of the song and kind of sort of plan it out a little bit, that it makes it a lot easier for the creative part to come.
Sure.
And that so it's, you know, kind of made things a lot easier. And so this last time we went in the studio, we had maybe three ideas, and then, you know, came up with four or five just kind of on the spot here and there. And whenever we sort of hit a roadblock, we go back to the riff bank and, you know, take something from, you know, a couple years past or whatever, and then just sort of...
Do you find these can come out in jams as well? Do you guys ever get together in that way and then all of a sudden a song's born?
Not usually full songs, maybe parts that will start with, you know, starting points. But yeah, I mean, like I said, the song Maniac, that was from a jam that we did 5 years ago.
Oh, wow, okay.
So, yeah, it can happen any manner of ways.
And what about gear on the record? What were you using for this one?
I was using, I had a few of my Schecter guitars. We also used ES-335. We used a Tele. And then for amps, we used JCM-800. We used a Bad Cat,
okay,
and we used a Hughes and Kettner 5-watt, and then pedals. It was, I don't even remember. I know that we used some Earthquaker stuff.
You just get some sounds that you're happy with, and then
Our producer Colin was he was the one who was like in charge of the pedals, and almost invariably it would be him tweaking the knobs while I was playing.
Ah, okay.
So it's nearly impossible for me to recreate that live.
I was gonna say, is that, you know, is that just for like some extra textures on the record? But it sounds like it's for main parts. So.
Yeah, well, both. Yeah. But still, it's like, it's, you know, producer's philosophy is always, you know, make the best thing that you can for the record and then figure out the live part later. Well,
too late. Yeah. Okay. Well, that's definitely one way of looking at it, for sure. You never been tempted by any of the sort of profile and stuff, the Kemper stuff? Did you use any of that?
We have done before, but it's just there's two parts of it. You know, there's the feeling that you're getting, you know, the directness that you're getting, and you know, to say that you're playing on amps in the studio, it's just, you know, it should be what you do.
Yeah, it fascinates me that, you know, you guys, when you've got the option to do whatever you want, you know, you can get whatever you want, and yet some guys are going one direction, some are going another, and there is that whole thing, some people don't feel the difference, other people do.
Yeah,
there does seem to be something though that's a little bit different. I can get the convenience live though, that's for sure. But what have you got with you tonight?
Yeah, we have Axe FX.
Okay.
For live, it's amazing. Like, it's, you know, it's everything is in one box. You know, we can take it with us wherever we go. Like in May, we'll be doing some dates in Russia, and we'll just take it on the plane with us. And
you know, you're gonna get that same sound no matter where you go. Yep. That's it.
We don't need to worry about backline that may or may not be what we ask for, because we've had that before. The amount of sounds and control that are in it to recreate those things, it's. You just can't get it anywhere else, aside from having a room full of racks. That you take on, you know, that take up a whole truck's worth of space.
It makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
Now, for guys like yourself who have been, you know, nearly two decades, over 2 decades now, you guys have been around. You've got a huge back catalogue you could pick from to play live. You've put out this new record. Is there still the same, like, drive to release new music when really you could just continue now just to play stuff from previous records and still sell out? You know, what is the drive to actually do music?
We still love it. You know, we feel like we would just sort of be resting on our heels if we just didn't And, you know, it's like, and for touring, it's like it's a band's main sort of income, I guess. And we wouldn't really be gaining that much by not doing records. So it keeps it fresh for us because if we didn't make new music, we would get bored and then we would just quit.
Sure. Well, it's just, you do seem to, we're in a kind of unique period now where there's a lot of bands that, I mean, can you imagine, like, when you were starting out in the band, we used to, you know, look at, like, the Rolling Stones and think, Jesus, these guys are fucking old, you know what I mean? Whereas, like, you know, so many bands now have, like, 20, 20, 25, 30 years, and some of them, you know, they don't always release new material, and it's always interesting to me. It's kind of like, do you just become, like, just almost like a novelty act if you don't release new stuff? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, that's what we feel like would happen. Maybe not, I don't know, but we would feel like that, and it just wouldn't feel right.
Absolutely. Now, something I'd actually love to ask you about is, you see, with enough a lot of these bands that are touring these days where you know, they'll actually have, like, say for instance Dio, right, who they'll do this hologram thing with. What's your sort of take on that, like, sort of artists that have sort of passed on and then there's a band that continues but actually plays with a hologram?
I don't know. I feel like you should get another singer. But I guess Dio is probably a special circumstance where nobody could really replace him. I don't think I would do it.
Yeah. That's it. It's just, you know, it's one of these ones, if you've not seen them live, then it's an opportunity to see it, I suppose.
Yeah.
But when you have, you just think, why would anyone bother? But it looks like it's been quite popular, you know?
Yeah, I mean, if people are going, then it's working, you know? It's like, who am I to say what?
Absolutely. Well, I just wanted to get your opinion on it. But look, Jerry, thanks so much for your time, buddy.
Yeah.
Have a great show tonight.
Cool. Thank you.